and safe and have a good week.
Good morning. As Unitarian Universalists, we strive to live in right relation by building the beloved community locally and globally. We do this by living in covenant. Please join me as we recite our PrairieUU covenant. We covenant to be a welcoming and loving community, offering each other fellowship, sanctuary, and a joyful spirit. We seek justice and peace in all our deeds and relationships, and we respect and honor both the individual and the collective search for sacred meaning and truth. We revere and celebrate the diversity of our earth and are guided by the spirit that connects all life as we reach out to offer our best to ourselves, our community, and our world.
Parents, this is your time to help our littles get their breathing buddies. So if you need to send them out to get a breathing buddy, have them do that now real quick and come back and lay down so they can find a comfortable position to get into and lay down during this time of prayer and meditation. So to our littles, I want you to get your breathing buddy and hold on to your breathing buddy nice and tight. You've met Puppy Love before. Puppy Love is Ralph Waldo Mouse's friend. And, you get your breathing buddy, lay with him on your chest, and relax as we enter this time of meditation and prayer. For the rest of us, I invite you into a time of meditation. So I invite you to settle in and join me as we come together as one body to reflect and send goodwill into the world. During this month, we focus on birth. And today we focus on honoring our Jewish siblings in faith. I invite you to take these next few minutes of meditation and reflection as we reflect on the times in our lives and in society when we struggle with great oppression, ambivalence, pain, and suffering. And in many traditions, it is believed that if you speak out loud your wish of goodwill, that it gives power to that wish. And therefore, I offer up into this on this day, in our community, our Jewish siblings in faith. We honor those who have died at the hands of the corrupt, those who have died because of non-action. At the time of the first Passover, the Israelites were held as slaves to a Pharaoh and to a nation. And through their faith, they were delivered from slavery. During the Middle Ages, they were marginalized into ghettos on the outskirts of society. During the Shoah, they were hunted and executed by a xenophobic fascist government and abandoned by the rest of the world. Still today, they are characterized as greedy bankers, corrupt politicians, and their synagogues and their spiritual homes are targeted for attack. Today, I offer the support and the love of this community during their great dysphoria. I offer that love to our siblings in faith in their continued time of need in this country and abroad. I now invite you to speak a moment of peace and love into the world by speaking of those you hold in your hearts as we send positive energy. I invite you to leave the name of someone in the comments or to speak the name of anyone to whom you would like to send goodwill at this time. And may we say together, blessed be. We speak of those we carry in our hearts as a sign of this community, as a sign that we care for the interdependent web of life around us. I bind not only those that have been named and made known to us, but also those which remain unnamed and held in the heart of this community. May the goodwill we hold in our hearts be a sign that we have come to a place in a way that connects the words of our mouths, the music in our hearts, and our very silent self as we share these next few moments of silence.
We are dancing Sarah's circle. We are dancing Sarah's circle. We are dancing Sarah's circle. Family, neighbors, all. Here we seek and find our history. Here we seek and find our history. Here we seek and find our history. Family, neighbors, all. We will all do our own naming. We will all do our own naming. Round a generation, every round a generation, every round a generation, family, neighbors, all. On and on the circles moving, on and on as circles.
Morning, all. This is Eric. This next song I'm going to do for you was written back in 1988. I co-wrote it with Jill Sobule and Robin Eaton. Jill had wanted to do a song for a while about the Evian Conference, which was a conference convened by European powers in 1938 or 39 to discuss the Jewish refugee problem. So this song sort of imagines a former Jewish refugee from the Soviet Union from 1917 coming to this conference to sort of speak on behalf of the Jews and falling in love with some military officer or government officer, probably, actually. Who was, actually responsible for making policy at the convention. They concluded at the end of this convention that there was really nothing that could be done about the Jewish refugee problem. Of course, very shortly, they were embroiled in a bitter war over that and many other things. So, anyway, this is called Evian. I hope you enjoy it.
Sweeping lawns in evening gowns, they stroll along beyond the villa to the grand hotel, where all seems well. The evening casts a languid spell. Let's fall in love beside the lake. Evian, let's have another drink and share each other's dreams. Let the water wash away these troubled times. There's nothing we can do for them in Evian. She left the homeland back in 17, herself a refugee, although it seems a distant dream. She asked him, what did they decide to do to help them through? He said, don't let it. Fall in love beside the lake in Evian. Let's have another drink and share each other's dreams. Let the water wash away these troubled times. There's nothing can do for them in
today's message is one that I know will be challenging for some of you. Over the next few weeks, we will engage in three of the most sacred times for all three Abrahamic religious traditions. Passover this week begins on Wednesday, Easter next Sunday, and Ramadan beginning on the 23rd. My goal for today is to invite you to learn more about each of these traditions, this week with a specific focus on Passover. Many of you know the basic story of Passover, but for those of you who do not, I'm going to skip right to the chase and speak very loosely about it. Passover is the remembrance or memorialization of the angel of death passing over the houses of the Israelites, who put marks on their doors with lamb's blood. The houses that were not marked were visited by the angel of death, and the firstborn in each household was sacrificed. And this is the middle of the story, though. There's a lot before and after, but this is the part that set the freedom portion of the story into motion. So this is where the transition begins to happen. The Israelites are then gathered up and get ready to leave Egypt. Now, I want to make sure that you understand that when I say the Israelites, I'm not just talking about Jews. We're talking about, statistically, there was slaves were released in Egypt. So therefore, what ended up happening was, approximately, scholars will estimate that 40 to 60% of the population that left were actually Israelites or Jews. The other 40 to 60% were others that left with them. So it wasn't just one group that was being oppressed and being released at the same time. So how do we get from there to here? Well, the Jews then left Egypt. They traveled 40 years in the desert. And that was a time of transition and cleansing. 40 years allowed them to get to their new homeland in Cana, which we now call Israel. So how do we get from there to defying the Nazis? Well, as I'm sure most of you know, Jews have been pushed to the outskirts of society for the last 2,000 plus years. And this came to a head in the late 1930s and 40s, with the attempted extermination of Jews both as a religious community and as an ethnic one by the Nazis, and specifically led by Hitler. Now, I am also assuming that you know that the story does not end there, that anti-Semitism is still alive and well in the United States and around the world. Neo-Nazis are living and breathing in our own backyards. Some of them are bold enough to wear swastikas, claim Hitler as their moral leader, and boldly proclaim that white supremacy is a goal for world domination. Others, though, are less bold. They don't necessarily wear white hoods or burn crosses or wear swastikas, but they definitely have a growing anti-Semite, anti-non-Aryan base that is undercurrenting a portion of our society. It is also growing, and it is being emboldened by many members of our current leadership. Like the Israelites at the first Passover, who didn't stand alone in their oppression, nor do Jews today. As Unitarian Universalists, we are called to resist and oppose anyone who violates our principles, especially when their actions violate our most basic principle of respecting and honoring the inherent worth and dignity of any individual or collective. And this is why I titled the message, Defying the Nazis. The title is a shout out to the Ken Burns PBS documentary of the same name. The documentary now airing on Netflix, and I hope that you get a chance to see it. If you were looking at our last week's newsletter, there is a link there as well. The story is a telling of a Unitarian minister, Waitstill, and his wife, Margaret, the Sharps. It is a story of their journey into Prague in 1939, to assist Jewish refugees escape the Nazi occupation, murder, imprisonment, and eventual death. Their journey was not taken lightly, and it was pressed upon them after 17 other Unitarian ministers turned it down. They had to leave their two small children, and they were not really actively wanting to do this, but they felt that they had a call. In any case, they left for Prague in February 1939 and quickly became vital members of the Underground Railroad, assisting both children and refugees who were being hunted by the Nazis for their political views and outspokenness. They assisted people out of Prague, Czechoslovakia, Germany, and France. They made appeals to the U.S. government that went unheard. They made appeals to the American Unitarian Association that was partially heard. They met with Norbert Chapek, the Unitarian minister of Unitaria, the Unitarian Church in Prague. Chapek is a father of our of Flower Communion. You may be familiar with that name. Chopik was also later arrested and murdered by the Nazis. In fact, Waitstill was in Paris at the very same time that the conference in Evian was happening. They arrived in Prague in February of 1939, and then Waitstill left for Paris in April and was there until August, making appeals for money, making appeals for support, making appeals for the lives of the Jews that he was encountering. But after appeal, they went unheard. And so they decided they needed to do the work themselves and extend their time that they would do their work. Their six-month mission turned into two missions for Waitstill and three missions for Martha. And they expanded 8 years. And in the end, they assisted hundreds, if not thousands, of people escape Germany, Czechoslovakia, and France. They saw the need and could not deny it. They were called to defy the Nazis. I am here to ask you to answer the same call with your own hands. Right now, we are in the midst of a pandemic, as you all know. But it is a time to answer the call to defend not only ourselves, but others from our modern-day Nazis. During this pandemic, we must be called to aid our poor, our children, and our refugees, documented or not, free or detained, those in camps or those not, where they will receive, if they are in a camp, a death sentence because of overcrowding, a lack of general health services, poor nutrition, and so on. If they are not in a camp, they will not receive that $1,200 check. They will not receive health care benefits. They will not receive care. They will live in fear. It is our job to answer the call. It is our job to answer the call to bring us to a level of society that does not marginalize the refugee, that does not look upon the other as somebody less than. We are called, like Waitstill and Martha Sharp, to go above and beyond, to reach out to our marginalized neighbors, be they Jew, undocumented, or other. We are called to care for them, to protect them, not only from the comfort of our own homes, but on the streets and with some risk. Now, I'm not advocating that you go out and put yourself in danger during this pandemic, but I am suggesting that you have to put yourself at risk. Our faith as Unitarian Universalists is not one of orthodoxy. It is one of orthopraxy. It is one that is a faith that calls us to do. It is a living, breathing faith that calls us to change and to adapt and to serve the community. There's an old proverb. My understanding is that it's a Jewish one, but that could be a lie. But it's about a man going to heaven and God asking him why he should be allowed into heaven. And the man says, God, I did basically good. I weighed the pros and cons. I didn't make too many waves. I walked the fence. I was always in the way of making dialogue and trying to be in that space where I was really trying to live a balanced, good life. And God looked at the man and said, that is good, except for the fact that the devil's the one that built the fence. If we are to be on the side of good, we need to be on the side of the oppressed. We cannot stand on the fence. We cannot live in a space where we are outwardly not defying anyone that oppresses our neighbor. Our neighbor is not somebody who we know by name. Our neighbor is not somebody who we know will be the person that will help us tomorrow. We have to go out and complete our job as a Unitarian and as a Universalist. Our job is in this space, or our call, is to take care of the needy. Our job or our call is to speak out to this administration, to speak out when people post and say flippantly that we need to allow our elderly to die for our economy, to allow our weak to suffer because they're poor, to allow our medical staffs not to get supplies, to allow for our states to have to compete with each other for supplies. It was announced, I don't know if it was Friday, I believe, but our own governor had stated that he was outbid for medical supplies by FEMA. This is not a concept that I understand. If we are a community and a society that is supposed to be bettering of itself and others, then we should be helping each other, not competing. As Unitarian Universalists, we must act. We must act for those thousands of people, those thousands of children sitting in detention camps, where they will die if COVID-19 reaches them. We cannot sit on the fence. We must act with our own two hands to protect the outcast, the downtrodden in our midst, because they stand before us. They stand in front of us, both as our neighbors and at a distance. We must act with our own two hands. If there is to be justice for any of our neighbors, I call upon you to defy the Nazis. The Nazis in this case may not be people who are wearing swastikas and going around saying Hail Hitler, but they are definitely a group that is out there who is banding together to provide for their own. They're not out to provide for society and to build us into a beloved community. Now, I know I'm stretching this term Nazi to a new level. But I know that when we look back at history, we must be asked, will we be Waitstill and Martha Sharp? Will we put ourselves at risk? Maybe not at a physical risk, but an emotional risk, a spiritual risk, a neighborly risk. Will we take care of each other as we go forward? Will we use our own two hands? So I invite you at the end of this message right now to understand that this message is not anything less than an invitation. An invitation for you to find a way to defy the Nazi in your midst. To defy that person, that government official, that individual or that collective or that system that will allow someone to die. Not because of anything other than their ethnicity, their religion, the color of their skin, their sexual orientation, or any other predetermined, prescribed gift that is given to them by their creator. I invite you to defy the Nazi in your midst. I invite you to use your two hands, to use your mouth, your voice, your strength. And if we do together as a community, Prairie may not be gigantic, but you know that we are a strong community that is built upon love and caring and truth. Truth that every person has inherent worth and dignity. So I invite you today to defy the Nazis in your midst, to use your two hands, and to go, as I say to you all the time, to go in peace, to be loved, and I'll close this in saying, blessed be.
Place with my own two hands, make a kinder place with my own two hands.
human race with my own, with my own two hands. Now I can hold you in my own two hands, and I can comfort you with my own two hands. But you've got to use your own two hands, use your own.
Since 1999, PrairieUU has offered itself as a liberal religious light on the prairie of the Southeast Denver metro area. We are a spiritual home that opens its doors and our hearts to all people who thirst for authenticity and a connection with the mystery of life. During this time that so many people are being affected by this health crisis, we're taking on a new way of being in community and covenant. As you know, part of being in this community is by sharing our resources, our time, talent, and treasure. We are asking you today, and in the coming weeks, we'll be asking you to share in this covenant in many new ways. As you know, PrairieUU is not an institution. It is a community of people who come together in love and support. We need to be taken care of in a variety of ways. Therefore, we're asking you today to give a little more with your offering. We're asking you to give generously on top of your regular pledge or offering to also contribute to the Community Fund. The Community Fund is managed by Pastor AJ and the Committee on Shared Ministry to help members of our community who may need financial assistance. Also, if you're in need of immediate financial help, with items like making a utility payment or medical copay, please let Pastor AJ or a member of the Committee on Shared Ministry know. How do you do this virtually? You can go to www.prairieuu.org/give, and you will be prompted as to how much you want to give and for what fund. You can also give by texting 720-730-9388, and you will receive an easy short series of prompts for how to give. I want to thank you for your offering and to our community, and I know that it is generously given and gratefully received.
We do have a few announcements for you. As you know, PrairieUU is a vibrant congregation, and we invite you to find us on Facebook.com prairieuu.org/prairieuu. We also have several community discussion groups that you're also welcome to join. As well as at prairieuu.org, you can also find the latest information as to what's happening on our calendar, /calendar. Today after service, we'll have our learning hour. I will be presenting a new UU, Pathways to Membership. It is a time for us to come together as a community. We'll talk about UUisms and give some opportunities just for Q&A. This session will be really around the intersectionality of the Abrahamic faiths and Unitarian Universalism, so Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, and how we have interacted with those three traditions throughout the ages. And as well, this week, we want to let you know that we have several things going on during the week. So Monday through Friday at 10 a.m., we have the break room. And Tuesdays and Thursdays at 5 p.m., we have happy hour. These are non-agenda-based conversations. Just come, chat, check in, let us know how you're doing. And that's a great time to just, you know, chat with different members of the congregation. We have Tech Talk at 3 o'clock on Mondays. If you have a question about any of the technology we're using, we've also got some great people on hand to help with just general kind of tech questions. So maybe not even to do with the church at all, but, you know, just general questions. On Tuesdays at 6:30, we have people of color gathering online. Wednesdays at 2 p.m., Candles of Community. And Thursdays, we have 12 noon, our ancestors with Kelly, and then our queer space at 4 p.m. So those are all great times. This week specifically, we have a committee on shared ministry meeting at 6:30 on Monday, and then a finance meeting and a board of trustees meeting on Wednesday. So those are all great things to be looking forward to. Next week, we have a great service planned with regarding Easter, defeating Hades. So it'll be a fun service. So I invite you to come and join us again next Sunday. And, you know, this also after service today to join us for fellowship. There's several different fellowship groups. Go to prairieuu.org/calendar. You can get all the links. Just do that as soon as you leave this service, and that'll be a great time for us to just catch up. There's going to be, Rhonda will be hosting one room, so if you have any questions for her as the administrator, I will be hosting another. The board and the committee and shared ministry will be hosting another. The parents' room will still exist. The youth room will be there. So there'll be lots of different spaces for people to have small group conversations. So we hope you do enjoy and partake of that after service. And as we go forward, we invite you to prepare to leave our space in the spirit that these words take us, reminding us that our service does not end, but continues to live in our hearts. And may we go forward with these words from Mark L. Bellatini. Go in peace. Live simply, gently, at home in yourselves. Act justly, speak justly. Remember the depth of your own compassion. Forget not your power in the days of your powerlessness. Do not desire to be wealthier than your peers. And stint not your hand of charity. Practice forbearance. Speak the truth or speak not. Take care of yourselves as bodies, for you are a good gift. Crave peace for all people in the world, beginning with yourselves. And go as you go with the dream of that peace in your heart. And may we say together as we close our services that we believe in something greater. We wish peace upon the world. We see the divine in each other, and we bless each other and nature by saying together, Amen, Amin, Shalom, Salam, Namaste, and blessed be. That concludes the public streaming portion of our service. If you're a member of our congregation and community, you're invited to remain with us via Google Meet, and we will be celebrating our traditional Candles of Community immediately following the conclusion of the streaming part of our service. So we hope you have a wonderful week, and we'll see you next week, if not during the week, at one of our many opportunities to connect with community. Have a blessed week.